Hello and welcome back to another episode of the Billion Dollar Body Podcast. This is one of my favorite episodes, especially because I don't get to do a video all the time. So if you're not listening to the or watching the video version, you're definitely going to want to go check that out. It's someone that's near and dear to me. As you saw, I've interviewed people like Jay Abraham in the past, and we were in the office, and it was super intimate. We get to jump into different things that other people don't talk about. That's what I love to do here, and we're on a mission to redefine what it means to be a businessman, to create three-dimensional businessmen that are not just prospering in business, which is great, and is our obligation as businessmen, but also to prosper in health and relationships. The person I have here is someone that's influenced a lot of my friends personally. He's helped create a lot of eight-figure brands for my personal friends. Someone that actually in the past that I had a hard time trusting, and then you'll see him here with me today and how much I've invested personally in the relationship and also invested to bring him into an interview just like this so that you guys can eat this meat and get nourished by the things that he's gonna teach you today. Hear a little bit more of his story. And he runs a $150 million company out here in Boise, Idaho. Welcome, Russell Brunson.
Thanks, man. I'm excited for this.
I'm excited as well, man. I've been wanting to do this for a long time, and I didn't want to do it over Skype or on Zoom. And I remember Jay, he was talking to me. I know he's been a mentor of yours as well, and you've probably inspired him a lot on the back end as well. But he was talking to me, he's like, man, I hate all these people doing Zoom interviews nowadays and Skype. And I was like, you're the only person I've done in person, but it's really fun. But I appreciate you being here.
Oh, yeah, man, I'm excited. And I've been a big fan of you guys for a long time, especially now we've gotten a lot more intimate relationship-wise, and you're speaking at our event, and just have a ton of respect for what you guys are doing.
Yeah, and we talked about your event. Let's just dive into that real quick. Funnel Hacking Live, what year is this?
This is our fifth year.
Fifth year. And what I think is so crazy, I see entrepreneurial events all over the place. Mm-hmm. And I go to a lot of them. I have all the tags hanging up at my house, and everyone's event junkies. You've been to so many as well. And one thing that I've always honored about what you guys are doing is that you haven't leveraged a bunch of other people's audiences mm-hmm. to build an event. I've seen these people that are your tribe, that are funnel hackers, that go there for that specific purpose. They stay for every single speaker. And I just want to honor you guys for building that culture and leading by example in what you guys do. I see you swipe your credit card for things. You're like, I lead by example in what I do. You lead by example in your life. You lead by example in your family. I watch your Instagram stories all the time, and I'm like watching what's going on. And it's really cool that you leading by example is the biggest impact that I've seen you make, and it's influenced me. And if it's influenced me, I can't imagine the other people that it's influenced. So I just want to honor you for that just at the beginning.
Yeah. Everyone tells me that Nora's their favorite Instagram star, so she's becoming famous.
Yeah, she's going to be crazy. She's going to be like having awesome. When are you going to allow her to actually do Instagram stories for herself?
Oh, man. As soon as she can like fluently talk, it'll probably be the beginning. She's three, so she can't really more than sense or so. But no, it's really fun. And it's interesting because I think when I first got in business, it was a different landscape back then. It was pre-social media, pre-everything. And you see the people who are like the big brands and the names. And like I would look at those people and like, oh, my gosh, I want to get to know them. And then you go and you get closer and closer to them personally, and you realize that like, man, half the time like they're their lives are like all over the place. They're like, I remember being at events with other speakers and then afterwards hanging out with them and like hearing things they'd say. And I was just like, weird. Like I would assume everyone was like the same all the time, and most people aren't. And like, I think social media is awesome because it makes people more honest. And I think that's one of the big things I was afraid of initially was like bringing my family and my wife, you know, we're all scared about it at first, but it's nice because people realize it's just like, oh my gosh, like, there are good people doing good things. There's so much negative influences out there that people see everywhere. And like, I look at my kids who are just like, think these evil things are cool. I'm like, no, like, let's make being a good person actually cool. And like, and I think that unfortunately, most people who are doing good things don't want to show it at all because there's that weirdness of like, oh, I don't want to show people I'm doing good things. But it's like, oh, if you're not showing that to the world and people don't see it, they're seeing the other messages and it just makes the world a worse place. And so, yeah, that's kind of why we do a lot of that stuff.
Yeah, and that's how we've kind of taken on this journey of influencing businessmen, influencing men in households, and knowing that if I can change one house, if I could change one city, and through people leading by example. Because what I noticed when I went into business, I looked at all the people I could learn from, and all the people I learned from, I didn't want their life, but they had the skill set I wanted. And that was super annoying to me because no matter what, it rubs off on you. Mm-hmm. Like, you're around these people and you're learning from them, but little tiny pieces of them rub off on you. So for you, like, what's been that? What is your thoughts on people that are out there, they live this like life on stage or they live this life behind the camera and they do really, really well and they're influencing and then behind the scenes they're doing things that aren't congruent with their message. How have you, like, what are your thoughts on that and how do you like navigate that as someone who is learning as well? Because it can get discouraging for people out there that they think everything's perfect for people and then they see the behind the scenes and they're like, I don't want their life. Like, I don't like the way that this is going on. I don't like the way they talk about people. And like, it's discouraging sometimes. So how do you deal with that?
I think it's sad. Like, it was definitely for me, like, someone told me one time, like, you never want to meet your heroes. And I remember thinking, like, it didn't make sense to me at first. And then sure enough, as I started meeting someone, I was just like, oh, huh. And then, but I did meet people who were super congruent. And I remember just always thinking, like, I want to make sure that when somebody meets me for the first time, I don't want them being disappointed. And I struggle with that because I'm, and we've talked about this before, like, I'm super introvert. I know you struggle with that as well. So I've struggled. I meet someone, like, here in Boise now, like, never, it used to be nice internet because nobody in Boise knew who I was. And now, like, ClickFunnels is growing and stuff. I get it more. I'll be at the grocery store and someone's like, oh, Russell Brunson. And I don't know how to handle it. And like, and I used to like, do like just be weird because I was like, I don't know how to even like say hi back because I feel so out of place. I'm in my jammies, my hair's all messed up, you know, or whatever. And my wife, same thing. She's like, why were you so weird that guy? I'm like, I don't know. Like, I don't know what to do. And I don't. And so I've tried to like, how do I be normal to people? And like, how do I ask the right question when someone comes to me off the street and they're excited to meet me? And I've had to like learn those things because I don't know. I always want people when they meet me to not feel that way of like, oh great. Like, wow, Russell was weird. Or, you know, in my faith, I remember I had someone one time tell me like, you have to be careful where you are and what you're doing. And at first it didn't make much sense to me because I'm like, well, nobody, you know, let's say I'm in California, I'm on a trip, nobody knows who I am. But now it becomes more real when it's like you're somewhere and people may or may actually know who you are, and it just makes you, it kind of forces you to be more congruent to that. And anyway, but I think a lot of these things we have nowadays are, I don't know if you've noticed it, but I think a lot of the bad people are falling away because you can't keep up the fakeness if you're everywhere. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's too easy to expose those things nowadays. So
when you talked about faith, this was an interesting subject for me. I once went to a men's retreat, and this is where I kind of got the idea for BDB, and I don't want to like say anything bad about them, but I went to this retreat and everyone like believed in the same faith, and it was Christian faith, and I was there and we built this brotherhood, and it was super fun and it was really exciting, and I built this bond with all these guys. And then I left that meeting and I was like trying to get everyone together. I created a Facebook group for us. I was posting videos in it and none of them were doing it. And I was like, do you guys not feel what I felt building that connection and bond? And then I realized that it's because outside of that one environment, we didn't really have a lot in common. Mm-hmm. And so one, like, how has your faith influenced like the foundation of how you've built businesses and like the decisions you make daily as like a leader and the things that you do? And then secondly, how have you, like, you have commonalities with people, right? Like people that you hang out with that maybe don't believe the same faith, mm-hmm. but you get along because you love business and they're pretty ethical and whatever. Yeah. And then also like the people that believe the same faith, but you guys don't get along outside of that. You're like, oh, we don't have anything in common, but we have this like one thing.
Yeah.
First off, like the foundation of how has faith influenced your decisions, the way you live life, the way you build your companies,
yeah.
the vision, everything.
It's a big part of it. I feel like a lot of times the people who claim they have like faith or whatever are the ones that are like the most divisive, especially like on social media. It's like, God. And you know, and I'm Christian, obviously I'm a Mormon, and you look at the history of Christianity, like all these holy wars that happen in the name of God. And it's like, I've read what Christ said, and that wasn't like what he was telling anybody to do, right? And I think that it's been interesting. In fact, one of our clients, someone in my inner circle, Liz Benny, who's amazing human. And I remember when she came into our program, she said she was scared to apply because in my video I talked about something about how God had changed my life. And she was like, and Liz has a same-sex marriage, and she was scared to apply, so I was gonna like judge her or whatever. And I was like, when she came in, it was the opposite. I'm like, no, like I have my own issues. Like, I'm not gonna judge anyone else because I struggle with so many things in life. Like, everyone's got their own thing. And like, all I care about is like the faith side of business is like, how do we actually change people's lives? Like, I believe business is all about that. And it's not about me making money. I think most entrepreneurs, when you start, it is, right? It's like, I need to make money. But the ones that's their motivation the whole time, they don't last long. Like, it's hard to stay in business because of that, because that motivation, the motivation of money goes away really, really quick. But it's the people who like start there and they start like serving other people and they have some success, and you start seeing like lives change and you shift your focus to that. That's what faith, that's what religion, that's what Christianity, that's what God, whatever you want to call it, is like helping other people. And I don't care what sins any of us have, like, we all have issues, I have problems, I am so far from perfect. But like, I know that my mission here is like, how can I change other people's lives? Like, and for me, it's entrepreneurs, that's what I'm able to affect. But for, you know, Brandon and Kaylin, it's women who are struggling with weight loss. For, you know, all these friends we have, everyone's got their thing. And I believe that that's what makes the world a better place. That is actually, you know, that's what faith's all about. You know, it's interesting. I was, I serve a mission for my church. And I remember, like Mormons, we don't smoke or drink coffee or things like that. And And we'd found this person who we invited him to come to church, and they came the very first time. And I remember I brought them to church, and him and his girlfriend both brought coffee, a big old Starbucks, and sitting in our church. And I, you know, as a 19-year-old like Mormon kid from Utah, I'm like, what are they doing? Drinking coffee? And then like during, they stood up two times outside and were smoking, and they come back in, and I'm just like freaked out, like so scared. I'm like, you know, everyone here's gonna be judging because they're drinking coffee and smoking at church. And I just like was so scared. And I remember after the break, one of the older men in the congregation came up to me and he put his arm around me and he's like, you know what the best smell is in the entire world? I was like, what? He's like, cigarette smoke at church. He's like, that's the smell of people trying to change. And I had this like paradigm shift of like, oh my gosh, like I was judging these people. And it's like, no, they're like, what they were dealing with maybe more public than I'm dealing with, but we're all struggling, right? We're all trying to help each other. And if we can just love each other, then we can actually get through all that and actually help each other. And so, I don't know, that's been a big foundation for us as we've tried to do things. And
going to like the people we surround ourselves with, this has been super big for me. Any sport I've ever been in, anything I've tried to improve in, it's always come down to how can I get around really good people that are trying to move further, faster, that are way better than me, right? Mm-hmm. But in business, we can get caught up in that with so many different people that maybe aren't living the life that we want. But if we're around them long enough, we start like adapting to their environment. We maybe pick up some of their habits. We say something here and we're like, I don't even say that type of thing. Like, what's going on here? So how have you kind of navigated choosing like a mentor or friend groups that have that influence on you where it's positive, that don't just believe the same way as you and don't do any of the things around as ambitious as you, but also aren't just ambitious and don't believe any of the moral principles that you do? Like, how have you balanced that?
My belief is like, I feel like people, like everyone has really pure intentions. Tony Robbins, the first person, told me this, and he told me the whole story about this person who was one of his events, who when they're filling out the workbooks at Tony's events, you like tell your whatever, and the guy in the workbook wrote something about how he was planning on murdering his wife and his kids, and his partner saw it and was like, ah, and goes and grabs someone. And so Tony like does an intervention with this person, like trying to find out why are you planning on killing your wife and your kids? And you think like any of us is like, that's like the most horrible thing you could possibly do. And as Tony's doing the intervention with him, the guy tells this story about how like when he was a kid, his father left, and then his father left, his mom committed suicide, and then his family, all the problems that happened, and he was like, this guy was miserable. He's like, if I leave my kids, it's gonna destroy their life, and so I wanna actually protect them. And also you have this paradigm shift of like, oh my gosh, like they're not an evil person, like they have good intentions, they're just doing it wrong. And like, I'm a big believer in that. I think all people act out of good intentions. I mean, you look at, you know, people that don't make any sense to us, right? Terrorists and dictators and things that are doing bad things, like they have good intentions. They think they're doing the right thing. And so I look at that through that lens, and then I realize that and say, look, I may not agree with them, or maybe they are going down the wrong path, but what's their intention? What are they actually trying to do? And when you look at that lens, it's weird, because all of a sudden you start seeing like, oh, like that's why they're freaking out on social media. That's why they treat that person wrong or whatever it is. And so for me, then I'm like, hey, now that I understand like the lens of what they're trying to do, like now I can actually try to influence them, because they're probably the same goal I do. They're just going about the wrong way, and I can now come back and be like, hey, you know, maybe that wasn't the best way. But if we did this, like you could actually achieve that and not make, you know. And it's just it's interesting. And so for me, it's a lot of that is just trying to look at people through that lens, and then after you do, then realizing how you can influence them. And how not to be influenced as well, because a lot of times, like you were saying, that's the hard part, is if you're around them all the time, it can sway you. But if you're really looking from that lens of just like, hey, what are they actually trying to accomplish, then it's like, hey, how can I actually serve them in this spot? Or is it like, this is too weird and I'm gonna step away from it, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And so when you were going about your journey, I think every single guy out there really wants to be like, what is my lane? Where am I gonna be the LeBron James in? Like, don't we all wanna be in that lane where I'm like, gosh, LeBron's so good at what he does. He's the best in the world. Yeah. And sometimes, no matter what, if we're on our journey, there's some guys that are out there that are just crushing it. Mm-hmm. But I haven't ever not heard from any of our guys, like, am I doing the right thing? Every once in a while, like, is there something else I should be doing that I'm a lot better at, that I'd have full potential in? And sometimes that can cause indecision, which is the worst thing ever. And so for you, along your journey, like when you were getting started, did you have this desire to do what you were doing at the time, and like a desire to keep going? Or was it something that you saw opportunity in? That's the two different things I see from entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. Is either they saw opportunity and they were either mad or frustrated, or they saw this like something they could do, or they were just passionate. Uh-huh. And right now it's all about passion, but I see a lot of guys that have passion until they have to do it.
Yeah.
Because once you do it a lot, it's not that fun anymore. Yeah. You're like, this is hard. Yeah. And so for you, like, how was that journey of like balancing passion versus like, building a skill set and just going out there and like doing what you want to do? Like, how did you navigate that throughout the years?
That's an interesting question. I think it was probably opportunity initially, because that's what piques your interest initially. I was like, oh my gosh. Because I was wrestling at Boise State. I just met my wife. We were engaged and I didn't have a job yet. And she was making $9.50 an hour. So I was like, and my dad has been supporting me at this point. And after I proposed to Colette, he was like, just, you know, like after you get married, like you're on your own. Like that's your man now. I'm like, yeah. Well, you're not going to keep funding me? He's like, no, like you're like, that's done. You get married, it's up to you now. And I was like, crap. Well, I already proposed to her. I can't, like, yeah. You know, we're getting married in like 3 months. Like, I can't. And so I was like, I had to figure out how to make some money. So I'm trying, that was for me, like, big spark. Like, I got to figure out how to make money. And the internet's where I kind of turned to. And it was funny because at first it was just all about, like, I need to make money so I can keep wrestling. Because I didn't want to have to quit wrestling and get a job. And, like, that was, like, the thing that kept driving me. And it was funny though, because as I started learning it, I was getting so excited by everything. I know you experienced it too. Like, you start learning things, you're like, what? Like, your whole paradigm of the world and how it works, like, yeah. Shifts, and you're like, I feel like I got, like, a backdoor pass, and like, I want to, like, show everybody this.
It's like another dimension of life, just
over. Yeah. And it was weird, because I started telling everyone. Like, I started telling my dad and my brothers and my family and my friends and people at church and people at school and everyone, and they all looked at me like, oh, cool. And they're like, it was funny because they all be like, well, when you get it set up, let me know. And then, like, I want to do, like, you can help me set up the same thing. And I'm like, no, like, you have to do your own. Like, I'm still trying to figure this out. And, like, it was weird because they didn't have enough interest. It was just like, oh yeah, if it makes money, let me know. And I'll, like, give me some of that too. But no one ever got interested. And I was so confused. And so, but it became, like, such a fun thing. I remember on wrestling tournaments, I wrestled at Boise State, and Boise State didn't have a lot of money. So we didn't get to fly to tournaments. We'd just jump in a van and we'd have, like, 30, 40, 50 hour van drives. And so I would go and I would find these guys online who are making money, and I'd burn these CDs of them, and I'd have my car and my Walkman player, and everyone's listening to music on these long drives. And I'm listening to, like, Armin Moore and telling about teleseminars, and Alex Mendojan and Randy Chirac and all these old school guys from way back in the day. And I was just, like, listening to them and just, like, oh my gosh. And I became obsessed with, like, that part of it, because it was just so much fun to hear what they were doing and how they were doing it. And I didn't know how to apply it to anything. I didn't have any business, but I just became excited by that. I think for me, it shifted to the passion part of it, kind of at that point, because it became so much fun. But then it was still like, I didn't have a thing to apply any of it to. And so then I started trying to do different businesses. And in the start of my story, I did start selling potato gun DVDs, and I started selling information products, and just, I tried a whole bunch of different things. And we had success, a lot of them, but my favorite thing was always telling people. And at first, I said nobody I told cared, but eventually when I started making money, then like actual entrepreneurs started, like, showing up. I remember I spoke at some entrepreneur event. They asked me if I'd give a speech, or, you know, my first talk ever. And I showed my glasses and my shaved head and my little tie and my suit, because I wanted to be a businessman. And I talked, and everyone was just, like, listening to every word. I'd never had that before. I was like, these guys actually care about this cool stuff I'm talking about. And, like, that lit me up so much on fire. And I was just like, I want to keep sharing this with more people. And, like, that's what, where it shifted for me, and it became so much fun. And it's funny now, because I I'll stand on stage in front of 10,000 people and speak, and I just love it. But I'll go into a small group of people who don't know what I'm talking about, and like, I get so scared because they don't have that. But when you're in your room, and people, like, you speak and they light up, you know how it is. Like, yeah. It's just a different experience where, like, they actually are excited about what I am I'm excited, and you start finding your tribe, and that's when it gets so much fun. And then it's just all about, how do I serve the tribe? What can I do? What's the next thing I can do? And then it just becomes fun.
So you didn't have any business before you got engaged?
No.
So we almost need to give full credit to your wife for business. Like, do you think you would have gone 100%. And been as hungry to go after and, like, create an income if you're just on your own and you're like, I just need to make enough to scrape by. I don't need to be a provider. I don't need to worry about my future. Because that's kind of how it was for me. Yeah. I was just scraping by, doing what I really loved. I was going to different countries, serving the poor. I was, like, going on trips and speaking and doing things, but it was more like just inspiring, like, not needing to make any money. Literally, I made, like, no money at all. And then all of a sudden I got engaged, and I was like, I have a new responsibility. Yeah. And so that's why I went into business, is I was like, I don't want to be apart from my wife, one. Yeah. I want to be able to create my own life, but then also if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it right. Yeah. And I need unlimited income potential. I'm not going to just go live the normal life. So for you, was it like, that responsibility came on, and that's what finally gave you that clarity to, like, focus on business, that's what you saw the avenue was to, you know, provide, have your responsibilities taken care of? What was that like?
For sure. After, so we got engaged in April and married in August. Like,
what year?
2002. Okay. It's been 16 years. We just had our 16-year anniversary. Yeah, yeah. So yeah, and I just kind of started learning about stuff when we got engaged, and then we got married, and 100%, it was like this. I don't know if guilt's the right word, but it was kind of like guilt. Like, I was wrestling, I was going to school, and then she'd be working a job all day long, and then after work, she'd have to go and serve tables. And I'd be home and like waiting for my wife to get home, and she'd come home, and she was so tired. And I'm just like, I'm not a good provider. Like, yeah. And so I was like, I need to quit wrestling to help provide. I'm like, ah, oh, like that's been my life for the last 15 years of my life. Like, I can't do that. And it was just like, I had to figure out something because I felt that guilt and I felt bad. And so that's when I started. Every spare moment of my life was like trying to figure out how to make extra money just so that I could like not have her work all the time and not have her. And she didn't love her job. I mean, she had a good job, but she didn't love it. And I just, yeah, I felt a lot of guilt. Like, I should be the provider. I should be doing these things I'm not providing. And I didn't want to wait. So I had to figure out some alternate means to do it, or else I had to quit wrestling, which I was like, my two favorite things in the world, my wife and wrestling, I can't. I have to figure out some backdoor that'll make it possible. And so that's, man, after that, it was like all day at school, I was sneaking out to the computer lab learning stuff. And at nights, I was reading stuff and watching videos and listening to the podcast back then, but listening to CDs of just all this stuff. Because I was like, I had to figure out how to do this so that she can quit working. And I remember because my initial goal was like, if I can make $1,000 a month, like that would like double our income right there. I was like, $1,000 a month. So that was like my biggest motivation. $1,000 a month, then I keep wrestling. You know, she'll be good. She can quit her second job and then it'll be good. And yeah, that's kind of where it was at. 100%, that was what drove me to actually do it, as opposed to, you know, sitting around and just thinking about it or whatever.
Yeah, did you ever have that moment of retiring your wife? Like, okay, you're done now, like get out of your job, get out of all your jobs, we're good. Did you have that moment?
Yeah, it was interesting because we never knew, like, this is like my first thing, and so we always had this fear of like, what happened? Because, and I should probably tell you, like 4 or 5 times while I was trying to figure things out, I would create something amazing, and then like I'd find out later after I made some money that it was illegal, or it's funny, like most good ideas, I think, like the really good ideas are illegal, which is, you know, it's like, I remember creating this, it was like this chain, I read a chain letter, I'm like, I'm gonna make a digital chain letter. And I built this chain letter thing out, and it was really cool, and people sign up and they could refer other, and it was like brilliant. I found out later it was illegal, I didn't know at the time, but I was just like, this is amazing. And we launched, and the first day made $300, and I was like, oh my gosh, like that was insane. Yeah, my run rate. So I told my wife, and I was like, I told her, I'm like, you can quit your job. And she's like, are you serious? I'm like, yeah. And so we're all excited. And the next day, some lawyer sent me this thing explaining how chain letters are illegal and like all this. And I was like, I don't even know how to tell her. I don't want to tell her I broke the law. And so like, I stopped and I was like, hey, don't quit. And I'm like, refunding everyone's money because I don't want to go to jail. I don't know what was going to happen. I was freaking out. And then I was like, okay, that didn't work. And so I had a bunch of things like that like worked a little bit, and then they didn't work. Or like, we sold a couple, and then like we got some refunds, or just all those little things. And so when we first started making a little bit of money, then she was like, well, we have no idea how stable this was or wasn't. So she kept working. And eventually I hired my first employee, my first like assistant. So we had two people. And then about that time is when she got pregnant with the twins. And so it was funny because like when she finally put in her 2 weeks, and then she was going through the process. And the day she was, her last day, we had a doctor's appointment, and we went in for a doctor's appointment, and they also put her on bed rest that same day. And she was like, I'm free. And then she was like, put down bed rest, and like didn't get actual like freedom from it. But it was right when we got pregnant with the twins, right after that's when she finally was able to quit, and I could retire, and it was really cool from that point forward.
So you're talking about that point where you're just learning all the time, and I've been through that, and it's super exciting. What were some of like the biggest roadblocks that you hit for yourself? Because sometimes there's problems that happen, mm-hmm. and we're equipped and we don't even care, we don't notice. There's other times where it's something small. Like even this morning, like just to be transparent, we didn't have food this morning. And so we're like, how do we get an Uber and get here on time? And so it was like 12 minutes till the Uber got here. And then that caused like, I was mad because my routine's broken, and then something can happen in the business. And I'm like, I know how to fix that.
Yeah.
It's no big deal. So for you, like personally, what were those things where you had like a roadblock where you're like, I don't know if I want to keep doing this anymore, or if you even had that. And then how did you navigate that and like stay consistent, stay like focused on that one thing? Mm.
It's funny, like thinking back now, it's been so long, but try to remember some of them. And I think, so I'll talk about what kept me going. Because I remember listening to these people and like on the CDs while I was on the wrestling trips. And like, it just made such logical sense to me. I was like, it has to work. And like, these guys don't seem that much smarter than me. It's not like some trick, like, you know, you don't have to be like a genius at math or science or anything. It's just like, it's a process and you figure it out and then it works. And I like believed it, probably because they were in my ears for so many hours a day. I just believed that it worked. And so I just had to figure out the process, and I kept trying thing after thing after thing, and yeah, tons of discouraging things. Like one, I remember there was this auction site, it was kind of like eBay, And then there was eBay. And on eBay, I found this lady who was selling computers for really cheap. And I was like, why are these computers so cheap? I couldn't figure it out. And I saw over here on this other side, they were selling the same things for like way more. So I bought one from over here, and then I would go list it over here. And then the person over here was a total scam artist, and they didn't send me the computer. But then I had already sold it over here. And I'm going over here, and like, I can't give you the computer. And they're like, what? Like, you promised me this computer. I've already pre-sold to somebody else. I'm like, I don't, you know, so like this person screwed me. So I had to screw this person. And it was just like this horrible thing. And then I got my account shut down over here. And like that was one thing. And they're like, thing after thing, like so many of those things like that, where like, I thought I figured it out. And then it broke. And I thought I figured it out. And then it didn't work. And I thought I figured it out. And then it was illegal. And I tried to figure it out. And then there's just so many of those things. But I was just like, I know that it's work. I had such perfect faith that like it was going to work because there were people doing it. I just had to figure out like how to do it. And it's funny, I talk about a lot on my podcast and events and stuff. Like, I just like believe like this is worth pursuing, it's worth doing. Like, yeah, it's a pain at first. Like the journey is hard, but then looking back, the journey was like so much fun looking back. But it's hard, but it's like worth doing because when you do figure it out, like it becomes so much, I guess, easy. I remember my senior year at Boise State, I had a creativity class. And my professor's name is Dr. Murley, a little Indian dude. And he's like, you have to do something creative and like do a presentation on it. And it was like my first membership site I was trying to create. So I created this membership site and I launched it. And I had like 300 people signed up for it at like, I don't remember, 30 or 40 bucks a month or something. And I remember presenting that in my class. And I showed the class. And I remember my teacher afterwards was like jumping around. He's like, did you understand what Russell just did? He was like freaking out. And he was doing the math. He's like, that's like $15,000 a month you're making. And he's like, that's a six-figure year business. Like, and freaking out. And then he asked the class, any of you guys have any questions for Russell? And remember this guy sitting in the back, like, kind of leaned out on his chair and he like raised his hands. And he's like, and so he called on him. He's like, that seems really cool, but man, that seems like a lot of work. And I remember thinking like, I was like, yes, it was for like 2 months. I put in a, like 80-hour weeks for 2 months, but then it's done now. And now it's making 15 grand a month. And it's just, it's done. I'm like, you're going to spend the next 40 years of your life and not probably ever get to that income level. Yeah. And it's just interesting seeing that dynamic of like, you got to put in a lot of focus work for a little bit, but then you step back and it's insane. It's worth it. It's worth putting in the time.
Did you ever have a time that people didn't believe in Russell? Like didn't believe that Russell was going to do something? Like maybe the first time you spoke, like I know for me, I had a mentor that was super close to me and he was like, Amanda's so talented. She's amazing. If you guys are going to do anything, it's going to be because of her. So for a long time, I was like, okay. And then now it's very interesting because now they're very encouraging. Uh-huh. But I don't feel like a different person. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what I want to get across is, one, did you ever have people like not really believe in you where you're like, I'm not really like, when I make a video, it just doesn't go viral. When I speak, people don't just randomly think I'm Tony Robbins and want to buy everything from me. And even when I get in a compliment, I look at my sales or I look at my video views and I'm like, well, obviously not everyone thinks the way that you think. And then, you know, how much different is Russell now compared to the Russell a few years ago, mm-hmm. a decade ago? Like, are you really that much different of a person?
The time I remember the most, because the time that hurt the most, of people not believing me, wasn't like at the beginning. Because I think at the beginning, I was more, I have a lot of friends who like, they have an idea and they tell the world, like, I'm going to be, you know, and I was more shy about it. Like, not a lot of people didn't know what I was doing. A lot of people still don't know what I do. A lot of my neighbors and stuff like are confused. But I remember like I built the company up and I had at the time about 100 employees and things were working good. And then we had some hiccups and like it didn't work good overnight. And it was like I had to lay off like 80 people. And I had friends, I had family members, people like I loved that I thought were like super close to me who just like walked out on me. And that was the first time I was just like, wow, like they not see the vision. Like this is just like a bump. And I realized like they were there just for a paycheck. And like, oh, like, that was the hardest thing for me, realizing that, because I thought that like people had bought into me and the vision and everything, and it wasn't. It was like there was an opportunity for them. They showed up, and when the opportunity was gone, they were gone. And not everyone left, but a lot of people who had like was shocked that they left it. You know what I mean? It was just like that was really, really hard. That was probably the hardest for me is that time, and it was a couple year period of time to get things back on track. But it was a dark, like that part was really, really hard.
Was that tough in the family? Like, did that affect your own income?
Yeah, it affected everything. My wife, like we have like a paycheck, which she gets that runs the household, you know?
Yeah.
And so I was like, my mind is like, that can never change because I don't want to like rock that world at all. Yep. And so there was stability and security for my wife there. I knew that if I ever got low enough where like that got affected, I would just, you know, figure something, do something, but that never got affected. But it was from a stress and an emotional standpoint, like it was really hard. Like it was, man, it, it's funny going through that now, looking back, like it was, so the ClickFunnels never could have happened had that not happened. So I'm grateful for it, but it was like a dark, painful, like confusing time, you know what I mean?
What would you have done if you didn't get married? But that's my question. Where would Russell be? He would have wrestled. Would you have really gone after business? Like, where do you think the projection would be?
I'd probably been a wrestling coach, which is cool. Like, I love wrestling, but yeah, like it would have.
I mean, I wouldn't be here today, so that wouldn't be that cool.
Yeah.
What would I do if ClickFunnels wasn't around?
Yeah. How many other people's? Yeah, it's interesting how the little choices you make, how many more people they can affect.
And the fact that problem, like ClickFunnels wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that. And that's super interesting to look back, and it's always 2020 looking backwards, realizing that if I didn't do that and didn't go through that hard time, I wouldn't have been equipped for the new thing. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't have given me that idea. So that's very interesting, like the way that you're putting that.
In case anyone thinks that running a business like this is like all sunshine and roses, like it is painful. There's like so many people who are beating on you, like so many lawsuits that pop up now that we're hosting 65,000 people's stuff. Like we got a lawsuit from Taylor Swift the other day because some moron on our platform is like stealing her stuff and publishing him, and we own the servers and the domain, and like that's happening every day. And it's funny because I look back and it's like, if I would have had these trials 10 years ago, it would have crushed me. Like I wouldn't have been able to handle it. And it's interesting, like you look at life and it's like, I believe it's God, everyone can believe it's universe or whatever, but it's like, it's like you're given something and then like you're tried on it, which is like painful. And if you crumble, then like you step a step back. But if you succeed, like you increase your capacity, and it's like, can I go the next step? And then like the next trial or thing happens, and like it either collapses you or you fight through it and it increases your capacity. And it's like, looking back now, I'm like, holy cow, if it wasn't for 10, 12, now 15 years of that trying to beat me down and increase capacity, you know, I wouldn't have been able to handle any of these trials nowadays. Like there's some stuff that hits us, it's just like, man, 3 years ago this would have crushed me. But now it's like, you mean you talked about, like now it's like, okay, I can do this. I know exactly what to do and how to do it.
It's same as the gym. It's like the 30-pound weights would have crushed me a couple of years ago.
Yeah, it's now like, it's just like, shh.
Yeah.
And so I think it's funny because like we stress out so much about that. And it's funny now looking back, like the journey is the part that we always want to get done with, right? Like, we're always looking for the destination. We're running to this 100%. Destination because we hate the journey. But then it's the weirdest things after you get, and you get to the destination, then I think all of us are like, huh, that was it? You know what I mean? Like I remember some of the big, you know, successes. Like for me, my biggest first success was a state tournament. Like, I wanted to be a state champion in wrestling. I remember winning it and like getting my hand raised and then getting up on the podium, getting my awards and stuff. And I remember sitting in the car driving home that night and I was like, huh, like that wasn't quite what I, like that was amazing, but now what? Like now it's, like, you know, it's me and my dad driving the car and we're talking about the same stuff we did yesterday. And it's just, it was interesting. And then I started thinking about like that whole season and like all the stuff and the practice and how we killed ourselves and cutting weight and climbing the rope and like losing to that guy, but then like coming back and like I beat the guy in the finals last year early, and like that whole journey. And then my dad and I started talking about that, and I was just like, the whole drive home, we had a 2 or 3 hour drive home talking about that journey of it. And that was like so much, that was the coolest part about it. And then, and the same thing in business, like I've heard people tell me that before, like they killed themselves against Two Comic Club. They got on our stage, they got the award, and that night they went back to the hotel room and they're like, huh. Like that wasn't as cool as I thought, but like all the stuff leading to it was the exciting thing. My wife, she always tells people like the best time in our life is when we were like completely broke trying to figure it out. Like our first house.
You were like, no, it was not.
Yeah, it was horrible.
What are you talking about?
But looking back now, like I miss those times. Like our very first home we were in was, I think it was like 650 square feet. Like it was a bedroom, a kitchen, a bathroom, and that was it, right? And our bedroom wasn't big enough to have like a dresser in it. So we had to go to Home Depot and buy cinder blocks to like put our bed up on these big cinder blocks so we could shove our clothes under the bed in these like boxes and stuff. And then like I remember like we hated the room colors. We went to Home Depot and bought like some green paint, and we had these little paintbrushes and we're painting the walls. And like that was amazing. Like I remember thinking like, man, this is so embarrassing. I can't afford to give my wife like a dresser and whatever. But like, looking back now, like those are all the fun things we remember that made it so special and so cool, you know?
It's so funny to talk about that because I lived in a 400 square foot apartment and then I upgraded to a 2-bedroom house that was about the same size. So imagine how small the rooms were. And I actually did get a dresser for Amanda. Uh-huh. And I remember putting it in the room and I was like, I have no clue we're gonna get this out. So when we moved, I was sitting there and I was like, what if I could sell this dresser to the person that's moving in and it's already in there because I can't even get it out. And so we actually sold the dresser to the person. Yeah, so, and like, it wasn't that even that long ago. It was probably like 3 years ago. Uh-huh. So it's very interesting. So when I look at like, I always look at how people progress. And when I look at a lot of the guys that we work with or even some of the relationships, I think information's very easy if you are clear on like exactly what you want. Like if people want to build a business, they want to build it online, even brick and mortar, whatever it is, like all they have to do is watch all your stuff. Mm-hmm. End of story. Yeah. Like I don't need to tell them what to do, but ultimately it's like themselves holding themselves back. It's always like the vision, what they think they can do, the belief that they have in themselves, the story that they're telling themselves, what they think is possible, the opportunities they're seeing, like all these different things. And so for you, what has been like that number one thing that you've worked on that's really helped you get to where you're at right now? Like you're at a fantastic place. This is just the beginning. You're in momentum. Things are growing. You have a 5,000 person event coming up. And it's like, that's not just because you sat there and like watched one video and you're like, oh, this is a new skill that I have that I can like use this skill. Like you also had to become the person.
Yeah.
But I don't know, like maybe there's something that you did specifically that you work on. Was it working on yourself? Was it working on your education? Was it a combination? Like we want the winning formula.
Yeah. So there's one core thing that's the biggest, and then because of that, there's a whole bunch of little things, right? The biggest thing is just belief. And I look at my role at ClickFunnels as the CEO or the head cheerleader or whatever you want to call me, right? It's just to give people belief. Because like that's it. If you believe something's true, you just do it, right? Like I remember I was wrestling at his tournament, and there's a guy on our team, his name was Mark, and he sucked. I used to beat him up all the time. And we were at this tournament, and we were the same weight class, whatever, and anyway, I'm wrestling this other guy, and the guy is good, and this guy's beating me. And I remember during the break, I came over, my coach looked at me, and he just like shook his head. I'm like, what? I'm like, this dude's good. And he's like, Mark beat him last round. I'm like, what? Like, freaking Mark sucks. I remember thinking that, and I walked back out there, and I tech-followed the guy. And it was just like, because I believed I could do it, right?
Yep.
And I look at like the ups and downs for me. Like, I had, I don't know what it was. Like, I was blessed with some vision of like, I knew that, I don't know what it was gonna look like, but I had such belief that like it was gonna happen. Like, I didn't care, like I just went up and like through everything. I remember when our company collapsed and I had to fire 80 people. One of my now partners, Brent Co-Peters, he came to the office and he was like, my wife wants me to quit. He's like, and I basically gave him like a 50% pay decrease. I'm like, I can't afford to pay you. Anyway, so we cut his pay in half. And he's like, I'm scared, I'm nervous. He's like, is this gonna work? I was like, oh yeah. Like, I don't know how, but like I have perfect belief it will. He's like, cool, I'm in then. And he stuck with me because of my belief. And like, I don't know, I just have belief of this thing. And so because I believe in that, it's like, okay, now I know I can do it. I believe it, like I'm just gonna go, and now there's all these little things, right? There's all the little habits you have to create to be able to get there. But I think that's the biggest thing is actually believing. I think when people get stuck, it's because they're like, I think this will work. And that's why you don't quite go all the way. That's why you don't quite finish the shot or do the thing or whatever it is, because like I think it'll work. You get to have like absolute belief and certainty that's gonna work, and when you do that, you just smash through the thing. And so that's the biggest, is just belief. And like again, if I can give everyone like just believe this has worked, believe it's true, believe you can, whatever it is, like as soon as you believe, like it everything becomes really, really easy. And then, like I said, the backside of that thing is like all the different things you have to get to get yourself to become that person, because that's the harder thing, is like, at first you're not ready. Like I remember when I first started this business, I just got done with wrestling, I didn't hit my goals, my wife got pregnant with twins, I gained like a lot of weight, like it was really fun. She was eating for three, I was eating with her, and we both gained like, I don't know, 60 something pounds, and then she had babies and lost it all, and I was just like overweight for a while. And then that was fast forward 6 years later. Like I remember one day I was looking in the mirror and I had a shaved head, these glasses on. And I was just like, what in the world happened to me? Like I was like Division I athlete, and like I was horrible, and like I was struggling not just there, but in business and all sorts of things. And I was like, I have to get these things, I have to get back into a spot where I can actually feel good, or I can't have all the other things, right? And so I had to get back and like learn how to eat again, learn how to exercise, learn how to do these things, and get set these habits that'll like help me become who I need to be to execute on this thing. Same thing with religion. Like there's times when like I struggle or I don't do the things, right? It's like, hey, what are the habits I need to do to help me to become who I need to be to accomplish this thing? As a father, God, parenting is the hardest part of everything, you know? Like every single day I see these kids, I'm like, man, what if I mess up their lives? What if I don't give them what they need, right? And it's like, oh, you freak out, but you're like, hey, I have belief I can do it. And it's like, what are the habits I need to create to help them to be able to become who they need to be too, right? And so I think those are the biggest things, is just having a 100% belief in the thing you're trying to accomplish, and then reverse engineering, okay, if I'm gonna do that, who do I need to become? If I need to become that, you know, how to, like my body and my beliefs and my, like all those things you gotta kind of figure out. And then that becomes a framework that gets you to.
Don't you wish we could just like package up some type of belief? Like,
here you go. How much does this belief?
Yeah. When I look at sports, that's literally what it comes down to, is belief. Yep. And I like for entrepreneurs, sometimes I think we get lucky that we could be the 200 millionth best business owner and be living a fantastic life. But for wrestling, like you had to be the top person or else you're not known. You're not. And my sport, motocross, if you're not the top 20 person in the world, no one knows who you are. Yep. Like the person that's never ever done well in his life. If he just ran, like something random happens, everyone falls and he gets like third place or something. And he normally gets 20th. The next race, if he just keeps rolling with that, he'll get fifth, fourth, third, maybe even win. Mm-hmm. Only because of the belief that he had from finally getting that one break. Mm-hmm. And that one break, they roll on it and it becomes confidence, and then they sometimes become the best person in the world. Mm-hmm. And I've seen it happen over and over again. Yeah. And same thing with business. It's like, that's the core thing.
And I also see people on the other side. I have friends, I've been doing this now 15 years. I've had friends hit companies, $100 million companies, who are like in bankruptcy now, or just like going back and getting day jobs. And for them, it's the opposite. It's like they lost the belief, like some trial or hit them in their life or something happened where they didn't increase their capacity and it broke them. And then they lose their belief and it's, everything crumbles. And it's like, oh, like you have to be okay with not always having success. Like I had this really cool experience where I was in, a bunch of the fitness guys invited me to this thing. And I was like the only non-fitness dude at it. It was in Mexico and it was really cool. And one of the guys I was hanging out with is a dude who he builds and sells companies and just worth a ton of money. And I'm sitting next to him at dinner and he starts asking me these questions and just grilling me on stuff, you know, and I'm telling him the highlight reel because that's what we do as entrepreneurs. And he's like, no. He's like, tell me about like the tough times. Like, what have you failed through? And I was just like in the middle of a really bad thing. And I was just like, ah. So I went and told him like the first time I almost crashed my company and then how we rebounded. The second time how I like, crashed it and then I'm trying to rebound it now. And he looked at me, he's like, good. I'm like, what do you mean good? He's like, you've cycled. I'm like, what does that mean? And he's like, you've cycled. He's like, most entrepreneurs, he's like, the first time you have success, you come up here and like, you believe your own bio, you're drinking your own Kool-Aid. And he's like, you're overconfident. He's like, I won't work with entrepreneurs who haven't cycled at least once. He's like, you cycled twice. He's like, you're gonna be humble enough to actually like build something amazing. And I remember thinking, it was so, first off, it was cool to not have it called a failure. It was a cycle. And that gave me some like relief of like, oh, I just cycled. Like the best ones do that. And then it was like, okay, now that I've cycled, now what I learned from this, I can come back and do something bigger. And so I think a lot of times is when the failures do happen, because they're gonna happen, sometimes that's like essential for the growth and for the progression, is just like calling it a cycle or realizing it was like, okay, I've cycled, now what was I supposed to learn from this? I need to be more humble, I can't. Because if you looked at me pre-cycle one, pre-cycle two, like I was definitely more, I don't know, I wasn't who I am today for sure. I was more about the money and about the people and about the significance of me as opposed to like the significance of the people we're serving. And that's been the biggest change for me. And it's been fun watching. I think the entrepreneurs in our groups that are growing the fastest are ones that take the significance away from themselves and shift it to the significance of like their audience, like their customers, like making them the stars. That's where businesses like transcend and get to the next level. And the entrepreneur is willing to do that. And it's hard because most entrepreneurs are very significance driven. That's why we want to be on stage, we want people to see us. But the more I give away significance, the more I get. It's really weird.
I've heard this quote before that's, become the man that you would allow your daughter to marry. And you have daughters, so you're like, you could probably project in the future like what that guy would look like and who you would be like comfortable with. Uh-huh. But also I want to switch it maybe a little bit with that in mind on if Russell could have a mentor that he'd be like, this is the person that I'd like to learn from, that I'd like to glean information from, learn about life from. Maybe you already have a person that you look up to, but what'd that person look like? I always try to figure out not always what I want to do in life. Like, am I going to run a virtual company or brick and mortar? Or am I going to buy, sell companies and be a philanthropist? I have no clue, but I do know like absolutely what I don't want to do. And that eliminates like 99% of everything. And so then I just had these few options left. And so a lot of times like stepping into that role, like, what is that person or who are you aspiring to become? Or like, what would be like those core values that people could hold on to? Like commitment's a big one that everyone always talks about. Mm-hmm. Like that's a huge thing that no matter what, if you don't have that, you're just not gonna make it. Whether it's in a friendship or like if people are like wishy-washy, they're never gonna be our friends because we just can't handle it. Like they're, you're not dependable. Yeah. So what are some of those core values that people can model out there?
So for me, as you're saying that, what kept going through my head is there's a quote from David O. McKay. He said that no success can compensate for failure in the home. And so for me, it's like, I look at that as like, That's the root foundation of success is what your home looks like. Wow. So how do you treat your wife? How do you treat your kids? How, like, what does that relationship looks like? Because you can have success in the world's view, but if your home's destroyed, then, you know, what was the point of it? And so that's for me. I'm looking at people who have amazing families, who are married, who have good relationship with their spouse, with their kids, things like that. Because that's success for me.
Inside.
And then you look at, like, now having that and still being able to do other cool things. Like if you can run a company or you can help other people, or, like, you know, philanthropy. I can never say that word right. People doing charity stuff, like whatever those things are. If they're able to do that and maintain that, like, that's what I look up to. Because it's like, it's easy to do one thing. It's hard to do both of those simultaneously. And I'm looking for people that have that. People that have both of those things, wow, success in some area of life, and still have kept success in the home. Like, those are people I model. I look at and just like, that's awesome.
Sometimes the closest people to you is what should matter the most, that respect you and love you and know you, rather than anyone can put a perception out there.
Yeah.
But it matters the close one. So the last thing, real quick, I had to ask this, is like, I got the Voxer and I don't know how it happened or whatever, but you were like, hey, like, Funnel Hacking Live's coming up and we're gonna have 5,000 people there. And I was just wondering if you would be interested. And I'm like, okay, if you and Amanda would come and speak. And I was like, that was very interesting, because there's a million people in the world, like, mm-hmm, or there's actually billions of people in the world, but millions that could have that spot, and there's very limited spaces. So for you, like, what was your thought process where you're like, these are people that I trust to bring in, mm-hmm, and like, what was the thought process around that?
So for me, when we're creating Funnel Hacking Live, it's funny because we get, I don't know, I would say conservatively 500 plus people who like beg me, like friends, like, this is why I should be on your stage and all sorts of stuff. And for me, it's different. It's not, like, I feel like my pulse is on our community, like, trying to figure out, like, what's happening as a whole. And when we do Funnel Hacking Live, like, it's completely a storyline for me. It's like, okay, what are the things that we have to create? Like, it's not just how to drive ads, how to do, you know, things like that. It's like, what am I trying, like, my goal, my vision is to get the audience to become better people, right? Like, business, I feel like for me, like, my mission with business is to get people so that they can shift the focus off of, like, money, because it's like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, right? Like, if you don't have, like, food and water, you're not gonna think about how to, like, build a house, right? You got food and water and you got this. And it's like, I feel like if I can take the pressure off of finances for people through business, then they can actually serve and have a big impact, right? So I'm always looking at that, like the event is about, like, taking that pressure off so people can actually serve. And then it's like, okay, what are the holes that people are missing? And you know, we've only personally known each other, you know, not that long, but when you were here at our office and you guys were speaking, you and Amanda both together, I can feel like your guys' like your relationship, and it's unique and it's special. And I think that a lot of people are sacrificing their relationships for business, which again comes back to what I talked about earlier, like, no success can compensate for failure in the home. Like, how do you create that? And you know, and it's something that people don't talk about, especially at business events typically. I know yours they do, but at ours, it's usually the tactics of things. And I'm like, this transcends more of that. And so, like, I just, as you guys were speaking, I just felt it way back then. And I was just waiting to ask you guys later, because I knew, like, I just felt like I just know you guys were going to speak on something related to that at the event. And as soon as I heard you guys speak the very first time, it was just, as we were building out the storyline, I'm like, okay, this is where that piece will fit, because now, yeah, I don't want people having success and their relationship gets destroyed. How do we craft that into the messaging of the storyline of the event from the very beginning, from day number one? So now as you're building these other things, it's with the spouse, it's with the partner, supporting as opposed to, like, pulling away. Because if you're not careful, like, I've had times in my marriage where the business, like, became a wedge between my wife and I. And there's times where it became a thing that brought us together. And it's like, if you don't talk about those things and figure those things out initially during the foundation, then what's the point of business? I know a lot of really broke people who are miserable. And I know a lot of poor people who have a spouse they connect with that are the happiest people in the world. And like, how do we have both? Let's talk about that.
Absolutely, man. Well, I appreciate you doing this interview. We're in your office right now. That was really fun. Some of the things I'm sure you don't really talk about that much.
Not ever.
Yeah, and it's just fun to dive into all of it. So I'm excited to be at Funnel Hacking Live. I'm going to be bringing my crew there. I was like, guys, we need to roll deep. We need to be the loudest crew. We need to be there. It's going to be so fun. So I appreciate it again.
That's awesome. Heck yeah. Thank you, man. I appreciate it.